Why is it important to swim with the sharks before 4 p.m.? What's with the 9-kilogram crab that climbs up palm trees and eats coconuts? What would happen if you put a pearl farm in this lagoon? Why are all the windward beaches covered in plastic that is washed ashore? And what does that do to the marine life and the people that live here? What's going to happen to that beach when the global oceans rise? These were questions that were asked to me by this man. You've heard of a place called Bora Bora? That sounds remote, right? This guy lives with one other person on a tiny little coral atoll 1,500 kilometers to the west of Bora Bora. It's literally in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, and the nearest piece of land is another little tiny coral atoll that's 500 kilometers from that, in the middle of nowhere. I had the opportunity to sail across the Pacific Ocean, and when you're doing that, me and some other sailors that I'll introduce you to end up trickling into this tiny little place because it's really the only place to stop halfway. And when I arrived there, I met this gentleman, and he reminded me of sort of this big Polynesian version of Harry Potter's Hagrid. He was a massive guy. He also happened to be the immigration officer for this particular little island. Him and the other fellow by the name of Appy was the conservation officer, and they welcomed us in. And when I arrived there, I actually became very popular because he had never met a scientist before, never mind a marine biologist, and his entire world is basically underwater, minus less than a meter of sand. And so between him and the other sailors that had piled up in this little tiny coral atoll, they kept asking me a ton of questions. You know, what's with this fish, and why does this work this way, and many questions like the ones I just posed to you. So within a few days of me being there, I offered to give a seminar, right? I'm a marine biologist, and what sort of an amazing dream that would be to give a seminar in the middle of the Pacific about marine biology to all these cool people that are around. So this is a picture of the inside of the nicest yacht that happened to be parked there. And so we piled all the sailors in there, and James and Appy, and I proceeded to tell them all the stuff I'd learned about marine biology and about these tropical reefs. I told them about why these sharks would stop what they're doing in the afternoon and kind of park themselves on the edge of this reef and open up their mouths, and these little tiny fish would swim into their mouth, but instead of getting eaten, they'd clean all the little parasites out, and the sharks would just kind of hang out there in a bit of a stupor, just letting them do it. And so I just was on cloud nine, right? It was the best experience, and I'm telling them all this amazing stuff that I've learned over my course of my education. And towards the end of that, James spoke up and asked me a question. He said, I live in this amazing place. How can I learn more about it, and how can I protect it? And then I was kind of going to give him a small little answer. And then another sailor came up, another woman in the back also spoke up, and she said, well, we're going on this amazing adventure. We're taking 3 years of our lives to sail around the world. How can we contribute? This is something we've been thinking about. How can we make our voyage mean more than just our trip? How can we contribute back to the places that we're visiting? And to be honest, the first thing that popped into my mind was that I'd been in school for 21 years. Marine biology, PhD in neuroscience. I'd spent a tremendous amount of my time trying to be a credible academic so that I could make real scientific contributions. And I couldn't answer them. So I'm going to step back from that story, and I'm going to tell you about this place, or this idea of science. There's something about science you need to know about. When you're pursuing a career as a scientist, you're going to eventually end up in one of two camps. You're going to either be a pure scientist, and their job is to seek knowledge, to pursue knowledge for knowledge's sake. And then on the other side of the camp, you can either be an applied scientist. And the applied scientist's job is to take some of that pure knowledge and apply it towards more practical endeavors. Okay? And so all the way through my training, I've been surrounded mostly by pure scientists. And in fact, three of my kind of most influential mentors, I'd had conversations with them, and they really prided themselves on the fact that their entire life's work, their research, had no practical application whatsoever. And that's how they liked it. And so, not all beaches, of course, are as pure as the one that I just showed you. Trust me, I know there's very few of them left. Over the course of the last few decades, some really serious problems have emerged. World-changing problems. A handful of which, of course, are overpopulation, pollution across oceans, resource depletion, and, of course, climate change. And so, if you think about that for a second, the scientific culture of that time was to not apply its greatest minds to foreseeing, understanding, and solving these problems that are emerging. So I ask the question, can science really, and the problems that it needs to solve, really continue to solely be the domain of experts? I don't think so. I propose a new culture, one where we encourage those who are not overeducated, those who are not specifically trained, but have the ability to contribute to understanding these scientific questions, and to give them the tools to do so, so that they can contribute, but not in a way that changes their behavior. Why? Because the problems that we're seeing have surpassed the amount of experts that are out there, both pure and applied, to solve them. So how do we do this? How do we inspire this culture? Enter the realm of citizen science and crowdsourcing. There's some really cool examples out there where you can go and you can contribute to solving some interesting problems. You can go online and you can help marine biologists solve whale language. Yeah? You can go on and listen to some little snippets of whale song and match them up. And between you and the thousands of other people that are doing that, you can contribute to solving whale song and what that potential meanings are. If you're not into the marine environment, you can go online and help find exoplanets. These are planets that revolve around other stars, stars other than our own, and between you and many people, you can try and, you know, resolve these things. Now, these are all really cool sources for outreach and ways to engage people and scientists, but I think they can be improved on in a couple of ways. First of all, one of the first problems is that you have to be engaged. You have to want to go and listen to whale song or go find exoplanets. And that's cool, you know, to teach on young people and to engage people in science, but that's somewhat limited. And in other ways, you might just not have time to do that, or you might kind of get bored and move on. The other way that I think you can improve upon this is that the people that are engaging in that don't really get to contribute. It's not that they're out there collecting those, you know, those with a hydrophone collecting the whale song. And so how can we encourage people to actually contribute in a different way? There's other crowds that we source from, right? So in many cases, they're not humans, right? So in Australia and other places, we take sensors and attach it to seals, and those sensors ride on the seals as they cruise down to the under the Antarctic shelves and take information along their way, as the seal's just doing what it does. It's foraging and swimming along, diving, making repeated depths to the bottom of the ocean. Here locally, we attach small electronic tags in salmon, and then we get to the information from those tags are automatically sent back to us, and we get to good information about their habitat use and their migration corridors. Now, the difference here is that we're not asking these animals to do something different than they would normally do. They're just doing what they do as animals, and we're collecting information off them. So the real difference that I'm proposing is that we use a passive approach on an active individual. How do we inspire this culture? Well, imagine if when you went outside, say you went sailing or hiking or climbing or mountaineering, and you went out, or maybe you sailed to the most remote island into the Atlantic Ocean, and you could bring back more than just memories and pictures and maybe a few trinkets, but you could actually bring back scientific data collected in a reliable and rigorous manner. What if you could sample the environment around you in a way that didn't cause you to change your own behavior, but allowed you to play outside, but with a greater purpose? That is, to play with purpose. So, as a scientist, I encourage the innovators of industry to produce or provide the technology and the tools that allow the active and adventurous to utilize their adventures and their trips and their recreational rituals to engage and provide the information necessary to solve some of our most pressing problems. As an adventurist, I encourage my peers to step up and to empower citizen science with your adventures. You don't need to qualify to do so. You're already able to. You care about the wildest, wondrous places that are your and serve as your outdoor playground. Empower citizen science and empower scientific research to help protect the places that you love. Thank you.